This is the application for the Reolink Go PT Ultra. What you see right here is when you first open the Reolink app, you see any connected cameras that you have to the app. For the Reolink Go PT Ultra here, you'll notice that it has a PIR indicator and then a settings bracket. We can access the settings bracket from another location, so I'll show you that a little later. In the lower corner, you could see that there's a sun icon, meaning I do have the optional solar panel attached to this, as well as a battery life indicator. If I tap the PIR sensor, you can see it's connecting to the camera. And now technically this is a live view. I can tap the PIR sensor again and you'll see it took a snapshot and here is indication of 4G. Once you log into the camera, you could see, you'll know it's a live feed because you have your time changing there, as well as right here where it says the name of your camera, just under it, it says 4G and then lets you know the actual usage. One of the things that I'm gonna point out right away on this is this pause. This will pause the live feed from your camera. So if you're trying to mess with some options and don't want to be using up your data, notice it's at zero right now, that's a quick way to do it so that you can play with all these other options. Starting at the top here, this is actually a siren. If I select this, it will trigger a siren, which sounds like this. I also have a flashlight. If I select that, what that will do is turn on the LED lights outside and it gets this little blue tinge at the top. I wish that Reolink would change this so that I had a better indication that this was on. Maybe fill the whole thing in white or something like that so I know. To the right of that are these four boxes. If I select this, right now we're on one screen, meaning I will only see one of my Reolink cameras. But if I select this, I can have up to four Reolink cameras in a live feed right here. Right there, I have one of my disconnected ones showing up there, but you could have up to four. And then selecting that brings me back to having my camera front and center. This is our settings bracket. We'll talk about that in a moment, but skipping over our settings, we have our three dots right here. This will allow you to switch between night mode and day mode. Right now it's on auto. I can tell it only do black and white, which will switch it over into night vision mode right there. Or I can select to only show in color. Now there is an option that will allow you to use the LED lights at night so you can have colored night vision. And then right there, I had a little indication that a pet walked through frame. So that's kind of a nice thing in a live feed. It will let you know what's walking through frame. Selecting our three dots again, we have immersive mode. That's gonna bring up your cameras as big as they can get without showing you any of the options. I'm going to select back and come to our three dots one more time. And then we have picture in picture. This is another great thing that Reolink does where you can have your Reolink camera open while you do other things on your smartphone, allowing you to see. If this is the first time that you're doing this and using an Android phone, you might have to allow it permission to do that. We talked about the pause button right there, but next we have our audio. So right now I can hear the audio coming from the camera. If I select that, it's muted. Right here we have a camera. Selecting that takes a snapshot of what you see on the screen. And then right here we have record. So this is recording in live time what is happening on the screen. Right now there's not a lot happening, but this gets saved and you can share it. I'll show you where later. To the right of the camera option, we have low. What this will allow you to do is change how much data gets used. So notice I bumped that up. And if we go all the way up to clear, right now it's 4,000. Yeah, so right there. Now if I pinch to zoom, you can see my wishing well there. Notice right now it's on low, but if I bump that up to clear, you should see the pixelation change. So there, you could see the difference in video quality and the bird flying away, comparison from high to low. Just keep in mind, high is going to use more of your data. So if you did not get a high data SIM card for this, you might not want to use this feature. And there's a bird. So if we zoom in, notice it's defaulting back to low. So if I go high, it'll clear up and then that bird should be much clearer. Oh yeah, okay, make me zoom in again. There you go. Bird's even farther away this time, but that's all handled through there. To the right of that, we have the ability to go full screen, which we do get most of our options. Notice we get a couple extra ones now with our microphone being shifted up and our PTZ controls, but we're gonna swap that back and move further down because right here we have our talk control. If I select this, I have the option to tap to talk, which is full duplex, meaning I don't have to hold this down to talk and hear somebody. I can tap to turn that off. You have earphone mode, which is noiseless. So if you needed to use earphones, and then you have your volume over here, which we have to enable talking first and then our volume. So we've got our volume control right there to allow us to hear from the camera better. We're gonna turn that off and then hit the X. Next we have clip. Clip is a nice feature where if I select it, it will actually allow me to zoom in on a specific location. So over here, I'm gonna select that well, and then it's zoomed in just there, and it's going to record the full screen. If I select a picture, it's going to take a picture of that zoomed area. If I hit record, it's only going to record what's happening in that zoomed in, punched in area. I'm going to stop the recording. The box itself is actually adjustable. You can see right there. So if you wanted to target specific details in a location. Next, we have our PTZ controls. Right now, you can see I'm in my centered location. If I select right there, you're going to see the camera is going to move. And then you see arrows indicating which direction it's moving. And I'm going to bring this all the way down to its lowest point so you can see where I have it strapped up. Now, the one thing you can see, there are arrows right there, but I wish that there was something along the edge letting me know, hey, that's the furthest point that it can go. If you didn't want to use the toggles, you could use this as a joystick by pressing in the middle and pushing it where you want it to go. So those were our PTZ controls. To the right of that, we have motion point. So we have first, return to motion point. You saw it centered itself. Reset motion point, meaning this is now the reset, which will make more sense if I do this. If I bring it back down to where I want it, kind of there, I come here, reset motion point. Now this is set as the definitive motion point. I'm gonna swing this over this way quick and then come back here and then select return. This will make more sense now. So there you go. That is the new point of which I set. That's what reset is. And then you have auto return to motion point. Can turn that on or off depending on if you were looking around and forgot to put it back. Well, this will swing it back and then how long it takes before it gets back there. So right now it's on 60 seconds of nothing happening before it returns to home. Next to that, we have preset points. So you can have specific points. So if I come and select add, I would come over to my PTZ and we're going to move this over and come to a preset point. We're going to add, we're going to confirm. And now I have 2 points. I can select one and it will automatically move the camera back to that location. Right there, move it back to that one. And then with our motion points, return to home, if you ever worry about it getting off track. Last bit here, our three dots is our calibration. Selecting calibrate will walk the camera through its full left to right panning as well as its vertical axis. So you can see that it can pan a full 360 degrees as well as up and down. Now it does hang out in its most furthest points a little longer than I think it would need to, but here you can see kind of what time of day it is and you're getting these sweeping views of what's going on, kind of giving you an idea of how clear this is, even on its lowest setting, helping you to preserve your precious, precious data, especially if you don't put a large card in it like I did. I ended up using an unlimited card, which has about 35 to 40 gigs of data, but I wanted to make sure I had enough when I was running my tests. And here you can see calibration is complete. And then we can select our X, and those were our PTZ controls. To the right of that, we have our playback. Now, playback is going to be where all of those motion clips that happen are accessible. What I want you to notice here is there is a timeline, and along this timeline, you can move your little red indicator, and that's gonna show you, hey, things have happened. If I wanted to, there is a filter option right here. If I select that, I can say, I only want to see things with pets, and then hit these three dots. Now, only pets will show up. So if I select this up here, it's going to show me something that had a pet, hopefully. All right, so there's no action on that one. We're going to come over to this one, which should have a pet. And that's not a pet, that is a person. But there could be another action that happens along with him walking around. What I want you to pay attention to is up here, you have the ability to slow it down. So right now it's on 1x, but I could slow it down to half speed, making it slow-mo. So we're gonna speed that back up. This is also how I would download this clip. I can select the download and this will bring us to our download options. Again, here is a great feature that Reolink has. This will allow you to adjust your clip length. Notice it's 14 seconds, but let's say I really didn't care about what he was doing after this point. I could select that, and now my clip is only 6 seconds, and I could see what it's doing, and then select download, and that will download it to my device, but I can also share if I wanted to. I'm gonna select done, and that is downloading of our clip. If I select this here, this will also show you a different view of your clips. And if I wanted to see everything when I did that, I'd have to do that. And then it will show you in more of a thumbnail layout. We also have the ability to select a drop down and pick a date. You can see based on when I've been doing this, the wake dates I can go back to and select and then view something that happened, or I can select it from the timeline up here. And we're going to close that because that is everything that we can do for camera controls and downloading of our data for the Reolink Go PT Ultra. But that doesn't mean that there's not more that we can do for this camera. And that's all handled through the settings up here at the top. We're going to select our sprocket icon and it's going to bring us right here. Notice we have our name, so Reolink Go. I could select this and it's gonna give me some personal information for the camera, so I'm not gonna show you that. Coming down, we have battery. If you were charging this, the battery icon would actually be green, but here you could see it's at 87%. If I select this, it's gonna give me a chart letting me know, hey, you can see I had it at 60, and it's slowly been increasing as I've been using the solar panel. Coming down to display, here we go. This is gonna give us a lot of options. First being, I can change the orientation of this for viewing. Maybe I want to flip vertically. Well, there you go. It's upside down. I'll flip it back. Maybe I want to flip it horizontally. For whatever reason, you need something to be on one side of the camera or not. All of this is done through these options, which is great because I see a lot of cameras that do flip vertical, but never have I seen one that does flip horizontally. We have our stream. Selecting this, here it'll let you know. Clear and fluent. Clear is going to give you the best at 3840 by 2160, 15 frames per second, maximum bit rate of 3072. Fluent, that's going to be your lower to save on battery as well as data. And that's going to give you a resolution of 896 by 512, frame rate of 15, maximum bit rate of 672. If I select any one of these, I can come in and change my options. So here, if I come up to frame rate, default, but I could lower this if I wanted to, but keep that maximum resolution, as well as my bit rate. I can say, well, I want it to go all the way up, use all the data if possible. And that's adjustable for these two options right here, which is great. The amount of customization that you get in a Reolink camera is unlike anything you've seen with any other consumer-based home security camera. Coming down, we have anti-flicker. Selecting this, well, if you live in an area where the LEDs are slightly off, you've probably seen some travel YouTube people do this. Well, this will allow you to adjust the hertz rate to avoid any flickering. Here we have our day-night mode. As we had set up before, I have it on auto, but you could do color or black and white all the time. And then here we have our brightness. I want you to watch what happens to the screen up here as I adjust the brightness. Notice you can really wash this out or make it almost impossible to see. So you can adjust this as needed. If you place this in a place that gets particularly bright, you can lower your brightness. Or if it's in a darker area, you could try and bump it up so that you can see a little better. This is a great option. Coming down, we have camera name. Notice it's in the bottom right and it's the name of the camera that I gave it. I can select this and I can change the location, date and time. It's top and center right there. Again, totally customizable. Watermark, you don't necessarily need this. That's just the Reolink watermark, but I like to have it because I test a lot of cameras and I want to know where my video feed is coming from. Here we have privacy mask. Pressing and holding will allow you to create a black square, which will prevent the camera from actually recording anything in that location. You can have up to three, and it's a great feature to have on a camera. If there's a specific area, you don't necessarily need to monitor. And then coming down, brightness and shadows. You can see all of these are on auto, but we've got color mode. I could turn auto, which will allow it to do what it does automatically, or I can reset the brightness, reset the shadows all on my own. I'm gonna leave that on auto, but you could do that with black and white and auto for the color night mode. Remember, I was showing you, you could change the brightness, but you could do that for each of the individual modes as well. It is ridiculous, the amount of customization, and we haven't even scratched the surface. That was all just under our display. Next, we have audio. Here we have record audio. If you live in a state that doesn't allow you to record audio, this is how you would turn that off. And then you can have your volume, so you can actually test your speaker to see how it sounds. Light, well, you have infrared and then those LEDs. So I have it switching between the two, and then you can determine the intensity of your IR lights. So right now it's gonna stay off. I'm gonna turn those on, and the intensity of my IR lights are at their maximum. And then coming down to our spotlight, we have our mode. So this is smart mode, automatically turns on when the camera detects motion, or I can keep them off if I needed to. I also have auto on for live view. So if you're coming in and it's dark, turn that on, spotlights will automatically kick on. And then here is your brightness slider for your LED spotlights. How bright do you want those to be? Coming down, we have our PIR motion sensor. You can turn this on or off and change its sensitivity. The camera does need the PIR sensor in order to detect things, so I would caution you against actually turning that off. Detection alarm, we can set up a zone for this, meaning, hey, if a person happens to walk over here, set the alarm off. Notice you could do that for vehicle, pet, and other. So you could set up specific zones for detection of precise people. So over here, I care about people. Now notice I did the paint mode. I could paint all and then erase what I don't want it to see. But you get that customization for each of those. And then you have motion mark, which is when clear mode is selected, detected moving objects will be marked, which looks something like this. Sensitivity, how sensitive do you want the detections to be? So person, 65 is what I have it at. I don't expect cars here, so I turn that all the way off. And pet, I have up to 71. You can adjust each of the detections. It is remarkable what you can do. Next is object size. Let's say you get child-sized people in your yard. You don't necessarily want to pay attention to that. So you can say minimum or maximum object. So you could say minimum object size of this in order to tell me what's happening, or a maximum object size of this. So if I've got a little itty bitty person, here's a box, I can make that smaller, and now it's minimum. Moving objects that are smaller than this will not trigger. I can do a maximum, objects bigger than this won't trigger. So you've got a plethora of customization that you can do. Camera recording on or off, which I have on all the time. You could put it on a schedule if you wanted to, and then you could even set up individuals. I only want vehicle during this time. I only want pets during this time. Lots of options. Post-motion recording. This means that once motion has stopped being noticed, how long after that do you want it to record? So in my case, I might move that up to 15 seconds. And then overwrite recordings. This will, if you run out of space on your camera, override your oldest recording. If you don't want to do that, toggle that off. Coming down, push notification, I have it on. What that will do is when it detects motion, it will send you a notification. You can turn that on or off or schedule. As you can see, I have all the time and I only care about people and pets. I could do other if I wanted to get notifications of other types of movement. Email alert on. This is very similar to your push notifications. You do have to set up an email address for this to send to. So if you don't happen to be in a place that allows you to have your smartphone, but you sit in front of a computer all day and can receive email, that's how you can get notifications of things that are happening around your house. Siren. Well, right now I have this off, but if I turn this on, what it will do is give us extra options. Siren sound, default, or I could do a custom sound, which I can make a very annoying sounding voice. Hey you, get off my lawn. What are you doing here? Get out of here. Go away. I'll call the cops on you. And that's going to send that information to the camera to play the next time it detects motion or I set the alarm off.
Hey you, get off my lawn. What are you doing here? Get out of here. Go away. I'll call the cops on you.
You can also change your custom sound if you wanted to, or you can use the default sound. Coming back, you have pre-alarm sound, which is if motion is detected, kind of warning somebody that they shouldn't be there. And then down here we have our sound test. We have the ability to schedule this. Again, type of thing that we want, vehicle, pet, or person. Coming down, we have share camera, which will generate a QR code for you to share the camera with somebody else who has the Reolink app. Time lapse is another thing that I really appreciate. Here we go. If I select try now, it gives me a couple of options where moving clouds, sunrise, sunset, construction, blooming, or I could do custom and capture starts, duration, interval, like these are all of your customary time-lapse settings. If you did a time-lapse, you could select it and it would show up here. And then settings for our time-lapse, we can override time-lapse files. So you have too many and you run out of space, you can overwrite them. Time-lapse is not something that I see in a lot of cameras, let alone in LTE version. So I'm happy to see something like that here. And then down here we have advanced. We can change our device password. We can change the date and time. We can reboot and we can factory restore our device. And then all the way at the bottom, log out of device and delete this device. And that has been everything that we can do for the Reolink Go PT Ultra in the Reolink app.